Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-Aliyy al-Azim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Abil Qasim al-Mustafa Muhammad. Wa alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin. لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره. We offer our condolences to Imam Mahdi أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف for the demise anniversary of his mother Lady Fatima al-Zahra سلام الله عليها. Inshallah, in this session, we will try to reflect a little bit on the ziyarah of Lady Fatima and some of the concepts which are mentioned in her ziyarah. To begin with, I need to talk a little bit about the concept of ziyara in general. What we learn from the Quran and Hadith is that we human beings can interact, can harm or benefit each other in different ways. Sometimes it's very clear, everyone can understand. Sometimes it might not be clear. It needs some vision. For example, when someone talks to us, we know that it can benefit us or harm us. When someone physically does something to us, maybe for example a doctor who gives us an injection, it helps us. Maybe someone gives a, I don't know, bunch of flower to us, it makes us happy. Maybe someone beats us, it's painful. So either by words or by action, we may interact. Sometimes it's not as obvious as these examples. For example, a person is just present. He's not saying anything. He's not doing anything physically to us. But still, his presence can make us feel happy, or can sometimes drain our energy. Sometimes we notice, sometimes we don't notice. Sometimes you go to a place, or you are in a taxi or on the tube, and you see your energy is drained, you don't know why. Or sometimes you feel very happy and joyful, and you don't know why. It can be because of other people who are around. In the same way that our bodies interact, our souls also interact. There is a famous hadith which says, Al-arwahu junudun mujannada, faman ta'arafa minha atalafa. In the same way that in dunya people can be organized into different groups, like in an army you may have different groups, each has its own leadership and, you know, command line. They have different tasks. Sometimes they may belong even to different armies. The souls are also like this. Souls also have their own ranking, their own grouping. And if one soul meets another soul from the same rank, then even without knowing each other in advance, they feel very comfortable with each other. Sometimes you see a person and you just spend little time and you feel as if you know each other for years. And sometimes with some people you spend years and you are still in the same position as before. So there can be interaction also between the souls. There are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted them with something special. They can be source of light. Whenever you meet them, you get this light. Even after they die. Because this light is not coming from their body only. This light is coming from the soul. And the soul is not affected by death. Actually, the soul of mu'min after death can become even stronger and more influential. If in dunya we wanted to see an imam, we had limitations because imam has to sleep, imam has to eat and drink, imam has to do many other things. And at each time, how many people can go to the room that imam is there and speak to him? But after imam departs from this dunya, all these limits go away. We can visit him day and night. We can talk to him, all of us, at the same time. Because the limitations of the world of physics disappear. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his love for humanity, has selected some people for some reason. That reason is very clear. That's not arbitrary. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has selected some people for some reason to act as mirrors and reflect the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to other people. If you visit them when they are alive, or even you visit them after they depart from this dunya, you can benefit from their light. The Quran tells us that you can find the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fi buyutin adhina Allahu an turfa'a wa yudhkara fiha ismuh. That light can be found in some houses that Allah has permitted to be elevated and his name being mentioned and remembered there. يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ فِيهَا بِالْغُدُوِّ وَالْآصَالِ رِجَالٌ لَا تُلْهِيهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ وَلَا بَيْعٌ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. These houses from which the light of Allah is reflected are the houses of people that they remember Allah and glorify Allah. In mornings, in evenings, throughout the day, throughout the night, they always remember Allah. Even if they are busy with buying or selling, still they remember Allah and they glorify Allah. And Sunni and Shia all have narrated that these are the houses of the prophets. Hiya buyutul anbiya. The houses of the prophet are fi buyutin adhina Allahu an turfa'. So if you visit house of a prophet when he is alive or when he has passed away, it doesn't make difference. You can get this light, which is reflection of the light of Allah. And the reason this person is able to reflect the light of Allah is because he remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly. So the light of Allah comes from their place. And we know that once the first caliph asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after he said hiya buyutul anbiya, he pointed at the house of Imam Ali and Fatima and said, is this one of them? And Rasulullah said, na'am wa min afadhiliha. Yes, indeed, it's one of the best of them. Not because Ali or Fatima are prophets. No, because their house is house of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they are Ahlul Bayt al-Nabi. So wherever they live, doesn't belong to them. They belong, those places belong to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't want to talk more about this ayah because alhamdulillah in some other places we have talked about it. What I want to say is that these people, these personalities, whenever you visit them, whether they are alive physically or they are alive spiritually, which is more than being alive physically, they can help you with remembrance of Allah and they can give you light. You can be enlightened, you can be inspired, you can be helped with forgiveness, you can be helped with purification, you can be helped with your du'as being accepted. If you are fortunate enough to visit them from a near distance, you are very fortunate, because then you would be able to be there present with your body and soul. But even if you are not able to visit them from close, and you from any part of the world, turn towards them, and by remembering them, you try to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still you can receive light. It depends on your reception. If your reception is good, you can get lots of light. If your reception is weak, you may get little, but definitely you get something. There is no way to turn towards these selected and chosen servants of Allah and get nothing. So when we want to visit Lady Fatima salamullah alayha, either from a place near her burial place in Medina, whether it is in Rawzatul Nabi, whether it's in Baqi, whether it is in her house, or from here we want to visit her and show our respect to the lady, it helps us to use some words. Ziyara as such doesn't need to say anything. When you visit someone, this is ziyara, this is visit. But we should also say something to explain first that we know which personality we are visiting, and we know the high position that that person has. We acknowledge that person's position, and perhaps also you have some requests that you want to mention. So these are the things that we put in our way of talking and reciting the ziyara. Otherwise, the very fact that you either go there or from distance turn away, turn your face towards them, that is ziyara. So now I want to mention something about a particular ziyara of the lady that is narrated from Imam Baqir alayhi salam. I am using a very early source, and that is Tahdhibul Ahkam by Sheikh Tusi rahmatullah alayhi. One of our four major collections of hadith is Tahdhibul Ahkam by Sheikh Tusi rahmatullah alayhi. And as you know, Sheikh Tusi is Sheikh Ta'ifa, is one of our greatest scholars, and he had a speciality, expertise in the field of hadith, in the field of fiqh, in the field of usulul fiqh, in the field of tafsir, in many different fields. He's very respected and very a special scholar. So he quotes in volume 6, page 10, this ziyara of Lady Fatima. The narrator says, حَدَّثَنَا أَبُو جَعْفَرَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ. Imam Baqir alayhi salam one day told us, إِذَا صِرْتَ إِلَىٰ قَبْرَ جَدَّتِكَ فَاطِمَةَ. The narrator of hadith himself was a Sayyid and was a progeny of the Prophet. So Imam Baqir alayhi salam told him that if you go to the grave of your grandmother, Lady Fatima, فَقُلْ, say this. So this is what Imam Baqir alayhi salam taught him, and it's registered, and alhamdulillah you have it also in Mafatih, in some other books. فَقُلْ يَا مُمْتَحَنَ امْتَحَنَكَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَخْلُقَكَ. Oh, the one who has been tested, who has been tried, who has been examined. Mumtahana. Mumtahin is the one who examines. Mumtahana is a lady. It can be mumtahan for a man or mumtahana for a woman who is examined, who is tested, who is tried. Ya mumtahana. Just this by itself shows that Lady Fatima Salamullah Alayha went through a challenging life. She had a challenging life. You know, when you want to have very high position, you have to expect challenges. You have to expect serious tests. There is no way to have very high rank without serious tests. Ibrahim alayhi salam was very seriously tested. وَإِذْ ابْتَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. He was tested very severely. You know some of his tests. Some of the tests maybe we don't know. But just imagine the test of being asked to offer his son that was long waited for, to slaughter him by his own hand. It's a big test, you know, it's not an easy test for someone like Abraham, who is full of love for people, and now has this innocent and mu'min son, that when he says, Ya bunayya inni ara fil manam anni azbahuk, he says, Ya abati fa'al ma tu'mar satajiduni insha'allahu min as-sabirin. Such a son which is so understanding, so obedient, so patient, so submissive. It's very difficult to be able to slaughter him. But when he realized that this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from him, he did it. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to test him. Allah didn't want him to actually do it, as you know. And Allah ransomed Ismail. So, you have to go through big tests and challenges so that you would be able to reach high levels. Lady Fatima was very highly, severely tested. To the extent that we start her ziyara with saying, Ya Mumtahana, oh, the one who has been tested, as if this is the most outstanding thing that we remember about her, that she went through suffering. Her life was very short, but with great suffering. When was she tested? Of course, she was tested during her life. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested her, Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala need to test someone after Allah creates that person? Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can examine a person even before that person is actually born? Me and you cannot examine something unless that comes to this world. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge doesn't make difference, you know, for him to be something about future or something about present or past. So even before lady was born into this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew very well what would be the response of the lady. So Imam Baqir says, say this way, امتحنك الله الذي خلقك قبل أن يخلقك. The one who created you tested you before creating you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his eternal knowledge, he knows what we are going to do. For example, he knows what each of us is going to do tomorrow, what we are going to do next year, what we are going to do 10 years later if we are alive. He knows all this. In the same way, he can know what we are going to do after we are born. He knows all this. But when he knows what you are going to do in future, then he would treat you in a special way if he knows that in future you are going to pass your test. This is a very important point, inshallah, from this majlis. If you remember this point, then I would be very happy. If you remember other things, I will be happier. But at least remember this point, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may have a special, extra, additional favor upon his servant or servants if he knows that in future they are going to do good things, they are going to be loyal, they are going to be patient, even from before he starts helping them and supporting them and praising them. Let me refer to a passage from Du'a-i Nudba and then give you some example. In Du'a-i Nudba, we say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you made a condition with the prophets. Sharatta alayhim az-zuhd fi darajat hadhihi ad-dunya ad-daniyya wa zukhrufiha wa zibrajha. You made a condition with them. Allah said to the prophets, if you want to be my prophets, if you want to receive revelation from me, support from me, and to be acting as my instruments for guiding people, one major condition, maybe there are other conditions, but one major condition is you should not be attached to dunya. You should have ascetic life. Sharatta alayhim az-zuhd. You have to be zahid. You have to be ascetic. You cannot think of collecting worldly gains like, you know, money or power or position or fame. Sharatta alayhim az-zuhd fi darajat hadhihi ad-dunya ad-daniyya. In different levels of dunya, you have to be remaining always detached and ascetic. وَزُخْرُفِهَا, there are attractions. You know, when something is coated with gold, this is called muzakhraf. Zukhruf means to coat with gold. Something which inside is not gold, but they put gold on it. You think it's gold, but it's not gold. It's just on the surface. Dunya on the surface is attractive. But when you go inside, you see it's very ugly. Daniyya, it's mean. شَرَدْتَ عَلَيْهِمُ الزُّهْدِ فِي دَرَجَاتِ هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا الدَّنِيَّ وَزُخْرُفِهَا وَزِبْرِجَهَا فَشَرَطُوا لَكَ ذَلِكَ. They said, yes, we accept this condition. وَعَلِمْتَ مِنْهُمُ الْوَفَاءَ بِهِ. And you knew that they are going to be loyal. It's not just they said, but they are not going to keep it. عَلِمْتَ مِنْهُمُ الْوَفَاءَ بِهِ. You knew that they are going to be loyal. فَقَبِلْتَهُمْ. So you accepted them. So when did Allah accept them? Allah didn't accept Prophet Muhammad in the age of 40. Allah accepted Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam even before he was born. Because in his eternal knowledge, he tested him. And he knew what type of life he is going to have. So he accepted him in advance. فَقَبِلْتَهُمْ وَقَرَّبْتَهُمْ وَقَدَّمْتَ لَهُمُ الذِّكْرَ الْعَلِيِّ وَالثَّنَاءَ الْجَلِيِّ. So you accepted them, you brought them nearer to you, and you praised them in advance. You read stories about, for example, life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That, for example, even when he was in the womb of his mother, when he was just born, when he was a little kid, when he was a teenager, you see that there is a special care for him. You see things that are not ordinary. And you may say, still he's a child. Why he is so special? Why he receives so much care from Allah? Why Allah keeps him away from things which are not a sin because a child, but still are not good? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted him based on what he is going to do himself. It's not arbitrary, but because Allah knows that what this person is going to do when he becomes responsible, when he becomes able to understand and distinguish between right and wrong, then even when he's a child, even before he's born, Allah supports him. So that in future, when he's going to act as a guide, there would be nothing bad attached to him. People would have no bad, negative memory of him. Even something that as a child you may do, and people may think about you in future, that as a child, you know, he made this bad thing. No. فَقَبِلْتَهُمْ وَقَرَّبْتَهُمْ وَقَدَّمْتَ لَهُمُ الذِّكْرَ الْعَلِيِّ وَالثَّنَاءَ الْجَلِيِّ وَأَحْبَطْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ مَلَائِكَتَكَ. And you sent your angels to them. So, if I want to give you an example from our life, I can give example of a teacher who is very experienced. You know, if you are a teacher for 20 years, 30 years, if you have experience, if you have vision, you don't need to wait till end of the year, till final exam comes to realize, you know, who is a good student, who is a bad student. You don't need to wait till they become, I don't know, 20 or 30, till you say this person has a bright future or not. After few days, maximum few weeks, an experienced and insightful teacher can tell you which student is bright and hardworking and is going to have a bright future. And then, from before he actually proves himself, the teacher tries to be helping him more. If, for example, I know that this student of mine is going to become a great scholar because he has the talents and he's hardworking and he's very pious, then I don't wait for him to become a good scholar to help him extra. From now on, I can help him extra. I can make myself more available to him. I can give him my books. I can give him my notes. I can be asking other teachers also to help him. I say, this person is special. We have to help him. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for all his servants, it's not only for Ahlul Bayt or only for the prophets, for all his servants that he knows they are going to be later, when they become mature and responsible, they are going to be pious, they are going to be moral. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps them even from their childhood. Perhaps even before they are born. If their mother, when she's pregnant, is going to eat something unknowingly, which is haram, Allah may make the mother vomit because of this child, so that the child is not affected. So, now we go back to the ziyarah of Lady Fatima. اِمْتَحَنَكِ اللَّهُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَخْلُقَكِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created you. So he has created you. He knows everything about you. He doesn't need to wait for you to grow. He examined you before creating you. It's very important. The one who created you tested you before creating you, because he knows what he is going to create. فَوَجَدَكِ لِمَمْتَحَنَكِ صَابِرَ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala found that you are going to be patient. This is very important. Lady Fatima salamullah alayha was sabira. She was patient. You know, sabr, patience, is perhaps, without exaggeration, the highest quality of any person. Hadith says, As-sabru min al-iman bi-manzilati ar-ra's min al-jasad. For iman, patience is like a head. You may survive without hand or leg, but you cannot survive without head. No mu'min can survive without sabr. Of course, some levels of sabr are needed for ordinary levels of iman, but high levels of sabr are needed for high levels of iman. Why? Because the more higher you go, the more tests would come. There's a beautiful hadith which says, Bala wal iman, al bala wal iman ka kaffatay al mizan. Calamities, tragedies, and iman are like two sides of the scale. Kullama zida fi ahadihima. Whenever one side is weighty, the other also is weighty, so that there is balance. The higher you are in your iman, the more tests, the more challenges, the more calamities may happen to you. Not only the sense of poverty or illness, it can be many, many other things. Your suffering can be seeing people suffer. You don't need to suffer yourself, or you don't need to suffer your children. You can suffer when you see human beings suffer. You can suffer when you see there are people who commit sins. A lover of Allah, when hears or sees someone is disobeying Allah, his heart is broken. They cannot see people disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you don't need just to physically suffer. Lady Fatima salamullah alayha was tested. She suffered in her short life so much that qualified her to reach a very, very high level. Actually, the test was so high that when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was informed by Jibreel about what is going to happen to him, he said, "I'm going to be patient," something like this. "What is going to happen to Amirul Mu'mineen?" Rasulullah said, "I'm going to be patient." But when he was told what is going to happen to Lady Fatima, he said, "Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un." The suffering of Lady Fatima was very special. First of all, imagine as a young girl, she went through all the challenges that Muslims went through, especially early Muslims, seeing all the difficulties that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and other Muslims were facing in Mecca. Life in Mecca for Muslims was miserable, was very, very difficult. Whether it be before Shi'b Abi Talib or during the Shi'b Abi Talib, those 3 years, or afterwards, the life was very, very difficult. Because they were living as a small group, as a small minority, inside the most ignorant and brutal people. Imagine when people have no mercy for their own daughters, how they would treat the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when she comes, for example, outside. When they were ridiculing the Prophet, who is the most honest and trustworthy person, how would they treat the children of the Prophet or the children of Muslims? To see torture, to see martyrdom, this was very normal in Mecca. And then in Medina, although they had a little society, they had a little community, but they were not leaving them alone or free. War after war, attack after attack, plots after plots. So she had to go to battlefield. She had to look after the injured people. She had to look after her father, her husband. And then having children without facilities, with very difficult condition. Life was very difficult. Losing her mother, very difficult. Seeing what people who are around, and I don't want to go into details, what they do to her father, and how her father suffers from people who are not far from him. You know how much it brings pain to you if you know there are people who hurt your father, and your father is so kind that keeps everything to himself and never, you know, mentions anything, and you know how much he's suffering. And this person understands everything. She knows all the plots that are being made against Rasulullah and against Amirul Mu'mineen. She knows everything. And then when she loses Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, although she had already a very difficult life, but this made everything worse. To the extent that in a poem which is attributed to Lady, she says, "Subbat alayya masa'ibu, law subbat ala al-ayyam sirna layaliya." So much of calamities and tragedies have happened to me that if they had happened to days, they would have made them nights. And then seeing what happens to the legacy of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seeing how all the efforts of those 23 years are now in danger, and how Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam is treated, and also knowing through what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had informed Ahlul Bayt about what is going to happen to her progeny. Because Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam didn't only suffer for the tragedies that happened to them or happened up to that time. They knew also about the tragedies that are going to happen in future. So all these sufferings did not affect her, did not make her lose her patience. فَوَجَدَكَ لِمَمْتَحَنَكَ صَابِرَ. Inshallah, if we get tawfiq in another majlis, we carry on with the rest of ziyarah. So we, inshallah, benefit from some recitation. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to increase our love and ma'rifah and obedience for Himself and for His awliya, the haqq Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad.